So it's my pleasure to welcome Professor Ngo Bao Chau. So he will speak on the recent work inspired by Langland's paper, Beyond the Endoscopy.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the Finnish for organizing this conference and the organizers for inviting me to speak. So I'm going to talk about some work inspired by Langland's papers, Beyond Endoscopy. So in this article, Langland proposed some non-traditional way to use trace formula. After sample trace formula, obtain information on functoriality principle. In some cases, that is well beyond the theory of endoscopy. Since some more 10 years that this paper starts circulating, but there's not really new results that have been obtained following this method, but somehow the progress that have been made are solid enough so that you can keep some hope. So I report mainly on papers that are written by Frenkel-Langlands and myself, and some recent work by Altug, and mostly some attempt of mine to understand this business from a geometric point of view, something I'm more familiar with. Okay, so let me start with something very familiar. The automorphic L functions. Would like to see as a trace. So let G be a reductive group. Over some global field K, and so pi is product times pi v, some automorphic representations. So pi v for non-Archimedean place, pi v is irreducible, admissible representations of G of KV, and for almost on and unramified. For almost on V. So, I mean, this assumes to split reductive group. So this means that the space of fixed vector under the maximum compact G of V is non-zero. So let me, when you have this Hecker algebra HV, a function on G of KV that are invariant, left and right invariant in the direction of the maximum compact, and that have compact support. And this is algebra, you know, some convolution product. And this algebra act on this space of fixed vectors. So this is very important to know that this algebra is actually commutative algebras. And it can be described in terms of dual groups. Langlands dual groups. I'm not very versed in history, but I guess that is how the Langlands, the dual group itself has been introduced. So the G hat is complex reductive groups whose the root data is obtained from G by exchanging roots and coroots, as it was explained in Van Schlosser's talks. So with this definition, we know that the Sadake isomorphisms say that this algebra HV is isomorphic with the algebra of regular algebraic functions on G hat that are invariant under the Hadron action of G hat. Okay, so for every function phi in HV, and we know a tinder phi, the regular function on G hat corresponding to phi via Sadake isomorphisms. So since as pi v is irreducible, this is irreducible moduns of HV, and it must be one-dimensional. So so there's so dimension of pi v g of v is one. And there are these unique algebra morphisms from HV to C. So that HV act on this one-dimensional vector space via that homomorphisms. Now, sigma V can be seen as characters of this algebra regular invariant functions. And so sigma V can be viewed as a semi-simple conjugacy class of the dual groups. So, and we can write these isomorphisms as trace over pi v of phi equals the values of phi check phi tilde on sigma v. Now let's row these some algebraic representation of G hat. So irreducible algebraic representation of the dual groups. Then following Langlands, you can define L functions, automorphic L functions as rho and pi, so depending on three very different parameters, and it is product of L S rho pi V of all places V, where for if pi V is unramified, then L S pi rho of pi v is the determinant of 1 minus rho sigma v qv to the minus s minus 1, where qv is the cardinal of small kv being the residual field. A big KV. Now, we'd like to see these factors as a function of sigma V. So, So let become psi of s be the function of variable sigma v, which is the same formula. So this is a function. This is no longer regular. It has some points, but this is a rational functions. On G hat, which is obviously invariant, and invariant under the adjoint action. So you can be curious to know whether there's some kind of functions. So this is not regular. But you can be curious to know is there any function psi in HV who tinned up psi is the Sakellaridis transforms. So the first question is there any kind of reasonable function psi S function on G of KV whose Sakellaridis transforms in some generalized sense is psi tilde S. So obviously, just to try to do it in the most simple-minded way. So let's expand. So can formally expand this determinant. So this is psi tilde. Thank you. Determinant of one of rho sigma of QV to the minus S minus 1. And then this very well-known formula, this is sum from n from 0 to infinity of the trace of the n symmetric power of rho sigma QV to the minus NS. And now these functions, let me denote this psi n. And this is perfectly regular function. It has its Fourier transform. This involves Sakellaridis transforms. So psi n is in C G hat G hat. And so sorry, I call it tilde psi n. And of course, this comes from some function psi n in Hecker algebras. And of course, what you want to do is somehow to make this psi tilde as just the infinite sum of those functions. Else it's not, I mean, here there's something to be checked, but it's not really difficult. No big danger to see that if the real part of S is big enough, then this series is absolutely convergent in the series. Absolutely convergent. But somehow this is not nice enough. I mean, when you try to geometrize the problem, you don't see, I mean, there's no room to put this complex parameter S in. So, well, in very single minded, I just want to, is there any way to situation you can just, this function can just be defined for any S? So can we define for every S, in particular for S equal to 0? And of course, this is not possible, but there is many situations where it is actually possible, and actually that doesn't, somehow is generally enough. So now I want to make sense of this function. So of course, then I have to restrict myself into some case. So two, no, geometric construction, upside in a restrict that setting. So if you start from this point of view, what we like to do is we want basically a formula like this. You want that some, you have this function psi, and you want that the trace of psi s over pi v maybe. Also, it can be pi or pi v, doesn't matter. It's a psi, a pi, twisted by some characters, some kind of determinant to the S, right? And so obviously, you need, for this form to just make sense, you need the determinant. And so this is just have, so in your setting, you have the group G comes with a determinant, to make sense, and assume that the kernel is semi-simple. And so if you dualize, you get a dual exact sequence. And if you just think a little bit about the formula, then what you would like to do is the representation row from G hat to G and V satisfies maps the GM, the central GM of G hat identically on the central GM. Of G on V. So that's basically the setting you want to put yourself in. It looks a little bit strange, but I mean, when you unravel things, that is just the right conditions, and somehow it's not difficult to put you in this condition in general. Okay, so now let us be in this situation. So when you look at this, the Cmin of rho of G hat into Cmin of Cmin of V, then the GM map GM, so this GL of on the GM sent on here by the nth power. And so so here the trace, taking the trace, so psi tilde n of sigma is the trace of sim n rho of sigma. Then if you do the inverse Sakellaridis transforms, it's basically clear that the psi n is supported in the subset G in G of KV, so that the valuation determinant is n. So let me go on this determinant. Okay, go on this determinant. So when you have this, there's no trouble to define these functions, because all the psi n has this one support. So psi n has this one support. And so psi with some psi n makes good sense. So of course, all this looks fairly familiar because it's nothing but more or less obvious generalization from Tate and Tate theorist and Goodman-Jacques. So this is kind of direct generalization. Of Tate theorist and Tamagawa Goodman Jacques principle L functions. And in this Goodman Jacques constructions, G is GNLN, G hat is GNLN, and rho is a tautological, is obvious representations. Representations, and they have explicit formula for this psi n. It looks like very nice functions. This psi is a characteristic function of the matrices stated. It is just the integral element that are non-zero, and in GNLN the matrices. So I mean then there's a quite natural question that you can ask is, does this have any kind of matrices that in a general case? And do we have something like the space of matrices in the general for the any group and for any representations? And the answer is yes, and yes, it's quite simple. So the question is, does there exist something like matrices, the display matrices in general case? And the answer is yes. And it is more or less a consequence. This is a consequence of Winberg theory of algebraic monoids, algebraic monoid. So then let me now recall you the this Winberg theory very briefly. So in this Winberg theory, the G prime is fixed. So G prime is a fixed semi-simple group. And what Winberg is looks at is the an extension of G prime by some torus, and but also a phi embedding, so M is in the phi, an open embedding, so G to M is an open embedding of G into some normal phi algebraic varieties. So of course, Winberg has more general theories, can maybe not even know a phi, and there's the whole much larger theory of spherical varieties. But let me stick to this situation and just normal phi embedding of the groups. And the assumption is that the action, the translation, the left and right translation of G on itself can be extended. Two action of G on M. And then because of this normal and phi assumptions, it can be checked that actually the two action can be combined into a monoid structures. Okay, monoid structures. On M. So we can multiply element, but the element may not be, you can multiply point, but they may or may not be invertible. Of course, you always think about the basic example that you know well, G and M is the matrices. It's a matrices. Okay, and Winberg had this notion of abelianizations. Of the monoid M. Is nothing but just A is M divided by G prime times G prime. I think just one copy of G prime would be enough. So this is GIT quotient. Just take function on M that are invariant under the of the derived groups. But if you take G, there's no invariant function. I think just the same. Yeah, it's not a matter. You can put both sides on one side. I think here it's not. And so we have this map from M to A, and M is said to be it's going a flat, notion of flat monoid. If the map M to A is flat with geometric reduced geometric fibers. Okay, so that time has a good monoid, so to speak. And the important result about Winberg is you can classify on the Winberg. Having 9 classifications on flat monoid with given derived group G prime. Okay, so what is his classifications? So he constructs a kind of universal monoid. Monoid, let me call this M plus. It's a fine embedding of some G plus. It's extension of the given derived group G prime by some torus T plus. And this map to A plus. And here, of course, A plus is a toric variety for the torus T plus. It's a fine toric variety. And it's universal in the sense that every flat monoid M, so with the abelianization map A, can be obtained by base change on abelianization. I mean, you just have M plus, A plus, A map to A plus, with compatibility with some torus action, of course, but I just don't want to make this precise, which is fairly obvious what you want to do. And to make the square product, and you get your monoid. But now let me give a brief description of his universal monoid. Okay, so let me assume the G prime simply connected. You pass through a semi-simple group just by dividing by the center or something. So it's fairly obvious. Okay, so you have this, then your universal group is. This is actually true for any semi-simple group. Not a T plus is the maximum torus of the adjoint group. So now, if you choose a Borel subgroup, then you will have a set of simple roots. Set a simple root, and using this simple root, you can identify T plus with the R's power of GM. And then your A plus is just the, I mean, the simplest half toric varieties that you can imagine, just embedding GMR to AR to the affine space. So this is A plus. Okay. So here is given by answer 1, answer R. And now let me recall the construction of the M plus. It's more, a little bit more elaborate. So now we have this, let omega 1, omega r, the set of fundamental weight. Weight, the duon to the coroot, alpha 1 check, alpha r check, and have rho I from G to Gn Vi, the irreducible representations of high risk weight omega I. But of course, we, all this work very well assuming that P characteristic is big enough. For small characteristic, people have been working out, but I haven't really looked carefully what is proved, what is not proved. So, so this is rho I. So this is, I haven't told what is G plus. So G plus is, G prime time T pi mod Z prime. So T prime is the maximum torus of G prime, and Z prime is the center. It has diagonal actions. So of course when you put the exact sequence, the co-canon will be T prime mod Z prime, which is the torus of adjoint groups. Okay, so the point that have a can ex- I mean not the point you can see that this is can be extended to G plus. So you have to write a formula, and if you write, there is actually only one possible choice for this formula: rho I plus T and G. Or maybe GT or whatever. So on G, you have no choice but write rho I of G. But on T, you would like to put the omega I. But also, you want to make sure that the center act trivially, so you want to put not the omega I, but the to make W0 of T minus 1. I mean, look funny, but I mean, that is the only possible formula for that. So omega I is the highest weight of the representations. Omega W0 is the longest element of the Y groups. And you want to put T minus 1 because you want that when you put Z prime, here it would act trivially. And so that is the only possible formula. Okay. And you also have the, then you can, on this together, you would have amphla plus rho plus is now a representation of G in a bunch of GM to the R and product of G and BI. Small g? G prime, yeah, thank you. This is the simply connected groups, yeah. This is G plus. So the rho plus is given by this formula, so it maps to this component. And the alpha plus is just apply the simple root to T. So get this formula. And an M plus, now I don't have. M plus is the, so this is actually injective, is a closure of G plus in A to the R time endomorphisms of the VI. So that is your universal monoid. Okay, so now let's back to our group. The group G that we start with, this so G, you have the extension of just GM, zero. So when you make a monoid, so I mean, toric variety of GM, you have more or less just one single one, this is A1. So to produce M, you need a co-characters from GM to T plus that can be extended. To A1 or to AR. And when you get this, you can base chain and get the monoid. But I mean, there's no mystery what this should be, this lambda should be. Because the what we have on the Dewan side is the on the Dewan side. We have a representation rho of G hat to G and V. And lambda is just this, the highest weight. V. And the fact that this is dominant weight is equivalent to the fact that it can be extended to map from A1 to AR. So this is highest weight, and so we have this map from GM from T hat to GM. So here's you need to make a little care. So let me say it right. So this is the T hat to GM, and if you do a light, you do get a co-character of G. And of course, you can compose it to T plus and get this lambda, somehow the same, denote lambda. And you have to check something. You have to check at least that. So now you have a map from GM to T plus. And you need to check that on the level of group, you have this T plus and G plus. And you make the square product, you get your G. But then you check, you realize that this is true by the assumption. I mean, it's derived from that assumption, it's derived from the fact that the GM, a central GM of G hat map identically on the central GM. No, no, in here again, this is true for engineer. Yeah. I mean, here just simply connected to make sense of this row I, where these representations. But in general, I have to do it, I mean, Winberg do it for simply connected and then divided by centers. But this is just true, yeah. On the central character, central GM. Okay, so you are pretty happy that you get some more of it out of our representations, but we need some little evidence that it is really what you want. So now, instead of the matrices, you want to look at the set. So now you get the monoid M. And you can look at the set of M of OV intersect with G of KV. Right, this is what Godemont-Jacquet did in the GNLN case for the standard representation. Oh, I have to better to go faster. So when you put MN, the subset of G of inside this OV, such as the valuation of determinant of G is N. And now you can see that MN is a compact subset of G of KV, and it can be checked. I mean, I erased it, but from the construction of the monoid, that MN is the right, it should support of psi. I mean, at least you can prove this is, but this actually, I mean, this is true. I mean, MN is really the support of this psi. Psi tinda some psi n. Okay, and if you some kind of variant of the geometric sata k transforms, well, it's not actually set up, but you can think about M n is some kind of algebraic varieties. Mn of is some there's some kind of Mn of KV, where Mn is some infinite dimension algebraic varieties, and this function psi n is a trace function of certain Perlberg shifts. Let me call it IN on MN. But of course, we are, so I mean, the whole point here is not about this single psi n, because if you have this just psi n, you can do, I mean, you do not care much about on this monoid. You can just do it by the geometric set of isomorphisms. Well, what you really want is some psi and some psi n. And it's right. I mean, I don't know how to prove it, but it's quite tempting to conjecture something like this. So let M be some kind of algebraic varieties of the residual fins, so that M of KV is M of OV map G of KV. And of course, M is union of MN as stratified space. And over MN, you have this IN. And you'd like to see the IN actually glued together to some I. So you want IN can be glued together in certain perverse shifts over on the space M, on big M. So they do not exist separately, but actually the whole things can be glued together. And it's somehow very courageous, but you can some purposes I, and if you, I mean, it's very tempting to think I is nothing but just the intersection complex of this M. And I made this conjecture based on no evidence. I mean, it does work in the case of Goodman-Jacquet, but somehow it comes to my mind because some other conjecture made by Sakellaridis. And I'm not sure it's compatible with Sakellaridis conjecture or not, but somehow it is. It was suggested by Sakellaridis conjectures. Okay, so now, for matrices true, yeah. For matrices, psi is characteristic function, this space is smooth. Yeah. Okay, so now let me move to the subject of beyond endoscopy, properly speaking. So, of L functions. Okay, so now, of course, I mean, when I talk about this loop space, I'm already in positive characteristic. And now I now exit a curve, and I give myself a point in X, and some uniformizing parameters. And I choose also homomorphisms into G, so that if I compose the determinant, I get some power M. It doesn't matter which M is. And so the if I epsilon infinities, which is in GM of A, addends, now it defines some immanent GA that I still note by epsilon infinities. So I want to look at this discrete representation that occurs in the L2 of GA mod GO mod GF and this edens up trivially. Okay. And then somehow with this function of psi, for at every PV not different from infinity, I can put psi V as test function, so to speak. And then what I get is the the incomplete L function, I was just wondering if you remove the infinite place, I mean to imitate the Arctic number theory. So I get this V different from infinities, and S rho PV would be just a trace, a product of psi V on V different from infinities on pi, twisted by the determinant to the power S. And so now if I'm willing to ignore the continuous spectrum, then I can arrive at the sum of these L functions. Is a trace of a product of psi v on L2 of gA, gO, gF, epsilon to the z, and twisted by determinant. Okay. So this is some other expression, I mean some kind of expression that we were interested in paper with Frenkel and Langlands. Somehow the very basic philosophy in Langlands' idea in endoscopy to say that is assume that is pi tempered, then the pole and the order of the pole of L prime of S rho pi at S equal to 1 is equal to the multiplicity of the trivial representations inside the regular rho of H H pi map to G hat, map to G and V of rho, where H pi is a Zariski closure. Of the Langlands parameters, okay. So it quite tempting to think that if you understand enough of this sum, you can break out your sum over the pi with the same h pi with the same that is closure of pi. So that is somehow what you are trying to do. Of course, you have a lot of problems. There's non-tempered representation. And so there's just too many A's that can come in. It's very difficult to formulate something, I mean, handy. Okay, you can try. But at least let me explain you actually this something. You know, I'm kind of run out of time, but this look from the first sight quite terrifying because the function that we use is not the usual function in the trace formula. Usually you get functions that have function of GKP at compactly support functions. Here we have some funny functions. But now, I mean, with the geometric interpretation, it's become pretty nice. So let me explain it in what this geometric expansion of these sums. Geometrically. Expansions. So, I mean, let's do it in the case of G equal to G and N. And M is the matrix. And the other case is more or less the same for this level of generality. So because we are dividing out by these edens, the space is the space of V, where V is vector bundle of rank n over x, and you have this equivalent relation V, equivalent with V twisted by infinities. And now we have a classifying stack of a pair of V and phi, where V is vector bundle up to this equivalent relation, and phi is the automorphism of V. So endomorphism of V, with generically isomorphisms. And now, of course, if you unravel it, so that we have phi had to be written as phi as V mapped to some V and infinity for some n. Right? And so instead of one single moduli space, you have a whole family of moduli space that embedded one to the other. So okay, Mn is just a moduli space of V and phi, and V is vector bundle of rank n, and phi if V go to V n infinities, and generically trivial. And look, this looks very much like Hitchin vibration. Oh, sorry. So let me convince the wrong R. Okay. And so, like Hitchin vibration, you have this Bn by taking the characteristic polynomials. Of phi. So this very much, when you put the whole thing in family, this very much the geometric model for this trace. And now on each level, it really look like Hitchin vibrations that we, now we have some kind of good control on it. I mean, even this case is not studied yet. And now the question is, but the question we ask is somehow different. We are not asking somehow calculating this direct image as a fundamental lemma, but understand somehow how it stabilizes when n goes to infinity. So, a cohomology of Mn, or somehow the cohomology of Bn, is coefficient in the direct image. And we just, you can look at the case of Gn1, and you can see it's quite a pleasant calculation, and you get just one geometric series that corresponds to trivial characters, and the other one thing will be finite. Okay.
Can you say what that last thing, H star Bn?
Right. Fn lower star of QL, direct image of QL. Fn is this map.
Fn, I see.
Okay, so, well, I plan to say something about the, it's one of the, I think, a very a main idea in the paper with Frenkel and Langlands is how we idealize the trace formula. But I have no time to do it. But and it's very exciting for me that in one case, non-trivial case, far from being trivial, Gn2 and the symmetric square, the whole program was pushed on the way to the end by Ali Altug. So let me finish here. Thank you very much for attention.
Any questions?
Yeah, in the function field GL2.
Yes.
you do symmetric powers this way by recognizing these geometric
powers? My construction works in absolute generalities, but I can do anything. The construct I present works in for any group, but I...
The last thing that you said is you could do GL1 because you could compute this, but in GL2 you can't.
I haven't. They should be...
So you cannot do the functoriality symmetric powers of GL2?
I can't do anything.
You cannot do anything?
Yeah.
I mean, all the... If you... prove all the necessary, all the conjectures.
I can prove this, and I think that it would say something about functoriality, but I don't know how. Up to now, I don't even have. I just say that this question about the pawns is equivalent to some stabilization process of this commonly space, but I can't even, say it in a clean way. This somehow is not going to prove it, but it's just say it in some kind of clean way. But I think that this geometric picture that just say you that you're doing something very reasonable. It's not...
When you say stabilizations with respect to what?
In the case of GN1, it basically means that it become... In the case of GN1, let me say this M3 is MN is... is the peak zero somehow of x time zero of x o n infinities, and this part is doesn't depend on n, and this part is a vector space, and after some range it just make one dimension more every time.
Any other questions? Okay, so we'll meet at 11 o'clock. So let's thank the speaker.